So, after you develop the system, you need training. And I'm going to introduce you to an exceptional trainer, Tim Cook, who is coming from Thailand. Tim has over 20 years of experience as a hotelier and as a trainer in the UK and in Thailand and in Asia. He is also part of the Dunn team. So thank you for your attention, and I'd like to introduce you to Tim.
Tom.
Thank you.
Well, everybody.
Sawadika.
Yes, I come from the land of smiles, Bangkok in the kingdom of Thailand. And we're going to be talking today about, is training really a need? First of all, who am I? Yes, I'm a hotelier. I'm a little bit different. I've worked in Europe, starting in London, Bangkok, Beijing, and a little bit in Africa. But I've also combined my career with a little time in education. Halfway through my career, I returned to London and I took over my old hotel school, Westminster. And in the last few years in Thailand, I've been running a training organization, focusing on language, but also developing skills training. So back to the question for today, is training really a need? We all hear those common excuses. I'm sure you've all heard, I'll only recruit well-trained people. We're in a massive growing industry. There was a report issued by Ernst & Young in New York back in January 2015. Our industry employs 266 million people worldwide. We account for 9.5% of the world's GDP, and we're showing a growth of 3.9% worldwide. Now that's way above the majority of industries. Can you find well-trained people all the time? No. Therefore, training is key. We have got to develop our industry. Now, I had a great example in a small island in Koh Samui in Thailand. Relatively new destination, and our labor force were the islanders. Their lives consisted of coconuts and fish. Skill level was incredibly low. But of course, the industry, we couldn't afford to do mass training for everybody. We got together. Instead of being in competition with other hotels, we worked as an island. We developed the skill sets for the island. We worked and the island grew, and of course, we all benefited. So that one-to-one competition, sometimes put that aside. Look for your trade, look for your destination, and look at how you can compare. The next one, I train them, it costs a lot, and then they leave. Well, that's another example supported by Samui. But also, don't forget, what happens when you don't train and they don't leave? That again can be an incredibly negative scenario. And last and not least, too busy. We're always too busy. We can always find an excuse as to why we don't have time to train, but we all know that's wrong. That one comes out of a training culture. Now, we set the training culture. It comes from top to bottom. And you all know, you can find 10 minutes today. And that 10 minutes, you can coach and you can train a skill. So, if within your organization, you're hearing these comments, you've got to change. Time to change. And where are we going? Well, all these changes are going to bring us towards the goal. And the goal, of course, is success. We don't want failure. I think you all know who this is. Sir Richard Branson. I think he's probably one of the greatest success stories that we can see. Started with luck, and luck often plays a role. Back in 1972, he formed his first music company. He had a lucky break. He signed a relatively unknown singer, and they produced an album called Tubular Bells. It was massive. By 73, he'd made his first million. Now, Branson has gone on, and I think you can virtually name any industry in any sector, and at some point he's been involved. But he's got a common trait. That trait is people. He's a strong leader. He's caring. He's innovative. He's active. But he has got one fundamental principle. You actually heard it earlier today. No, it's not the customer comes first. It's the staff who come first. And when the staff come first, what do you get? Happy team is happy guests. So putting that focus on your team, putting that focus on your most valuable asset, and things will come right. So our success, what are we going to get? Profit. We all want dollars. Prestige and acclaim. Now these are often our great contributors to what we call success. There's one thing I'd like to point out though, that success is not always that key to happiness. Very often, happiness is the key to success. And today, you're going to hear a word quite often, passion. When you've got that passion, when you are happy, when you are motivated, success will come. People, for years now, when I'm asked, what do you do? What's your job? Very simple. I don't say hotels. I say people. My world is people. My job is people. And people are the key. This young lady is Kuntim. She's actually got the same name as me. And she's one of our success stories I'd like to tell you about. 7 years ago, Tim was a spa therapist. And her boss, who was called Kun Pom, we invested in Pom. We actually put her on an international spa management training course. Cost us lots of money. It also cost Kun Pom a lot of pain. It was difficult. It was tough. And I remember the evenings when she'd come from her training course in tears. Tim, I can't do it. Go on, you can. And she did. And she blossomed. Now, we're all frightened of people leaving, but I'm actually quite proud when people leave and they've developed and their career is going on to be a success. And Kun Pom had focused on Kun Tim. She had developed from being a strong therapist, and she soon became the assistant spa manager. So when the manager moved on, we had no hesitation in promoting her. Yes, we invested in a bit of leadership training. There were some other management skills that she needed. But today I'm proud to say she is one of the finest spa managers in Thailand, and certainly the finest on Koh Samui. So for us, a wonderful success story. We invested, and then the labor turnover was no longer a problem. Tim was there to take over. Has anybody been a steward? Hands up. It's quite a tough job, isn't it? Hard work, hot, sweaty. And as we say, the steward is the unsung hero. Now, my stewarding in London, it was an era when there was a lot of what we called blame culture. And you knew full well, if there was a problem in service, who suffered? That blame cascaded down, and it's the poor old steward at the bottom that would suffer. And to the steward, relationships are hugely important. If you can make that steward a part of your team, it might be a low-level job, but it's a hugely important job. So how can our steward contribute to success? Well, the care of operating equipment. It's amazing how much a good steward can save and how much a bad steward can cost. We all know the plate might cost $9, but is that the cost to you? No. You've got to buy it. You've got to have purchasing. You've got to have goods receiving. You've got to have a storeman. And you've got to have capital tied up. So if you can control your breakage through well-trained stewarding teams, it can make a huge difference to your bottom line. Quality. I don't think people appreciate that the steward is really involved in quality. Across the world today, I think it's fair to say health and safety is becoming harder and harder. It's more demanding, and we get more people looking to see what we're doing. I remember with Jo, my wife, having lunch at Gordon Ramsay's restaurant in Horsebury Road. Full restaurant, busy service, and going into that kitchen after the service, it was immaculate. Not just the steward, no, the team supporting the steward. Another one was at Le Méridien, London. We had our Michelin star restaurant, and chef used little copper cassoulets. Now, when you put that on a table with a finger mark or a dirty mark, it screams. You're sitting there, you're looking right at it. Our stewards were responsible for that cleanliness. So they had a direct say in the quality of the product that was going on the table. Team player. Are your stewards all team players? Who wants to be the finest restaurant in Beirut? Does your steward know what he needs to do to contribute to that success? Because if he doesn't, he won't be able to. If it hasn't been communicated to him, he won't be able to contribute to your success. Anybody know who that is? In the middle. That's Ken Hom. Ken is the face of Asian cuisine in the UK. He actually came out of the US. And I work with Ken again in Bangkok. And Ken portrays a wonderful trait. He doesn't just come in and talk to the owner and the manager. Oh, Ken's in the kitchen. Ken's with the rank and file. Ken is building that team from underneath. He's communicating with them. He's talking to them. And he's inspiring them. And then the team becomes a great success. So here he is with the waitress and our chief steward. So how can our steward, or how can we use training to enable our steward to succeed? Training is often perceived as it costs us a lot. Well, I look back to my days again at Le Méridien, London. And we were able to put in a totally integrated training program for all our stewarding team, zero cost. Who supplies your chemicals in Lebanon? You have Ecolab, Diversey, big international companies. They got money. Yeah. Do you get anything back from them? No. London, we did. We worked with, it was Diversey. And we worked with our rep, and he had a budget for marketing. And we worked together, and we put together a training program. Now, in London, my stewards were not literate. Reading wasn't an option. So we devised, do you remember the old clock cards for clocking in and clocking out? We put clock card racks on the wall in the kitchen. We had laminated clock cards, color-coded by shift, by day, with pictorial explanations of what to do. Very visual, very simple, and the fact that my stewards, and I'm ashamed to say the way we recruited, was we would have a queue at the back door in the morning, and we'd say, right, today we want five, in you come. So there was no history, there was no previous training, but we took that training, we embedded it into the workplace, and we trained daily, and it cost us nothing. Apart from time and effort. So again, we know that our stewards can strive to help the success through the communication and through the motivation, being part of the team. shared acclaim and shared reward. It's another huge one. When you have your huge success, oh, chef, build up chef. What about the team? Don't forget the team, because they can play just as key a role. I've got a couple of stories. Here, you see Ken Hom, and he's with the canteen chef. Now, Ken did lots of training in Bangkok, and we always let people attend, and she used to come along. She was interested. She stayed after work. She used to look see. And one day we were doing a promotional event at the Intercontinental in Bangkok. It's always tough going into a competitor hotel's kitchen. And two of our key brigade had a car crash on the way. Do you know who did 60% of that event for us? The canteen chef. Now, Ken got a lot of acclaim for that event. It was a big public event in Bangkok, but he shared that acclaim. And she was the talk of the town in that hotel. She motivated another 200 people because the roommate saw it, the waiter saw it, a lot of the low-level staff saw it, and she had been acclaimed and held up for what she had achieved. Another story, and I feel a little bit conscious because we're going to hit the Mandarin Oriental again, that famous hotel in Bangkok. But when we were working, or I was working, at the Holiday Inn Crowne Plaza in Bangkok, we had an annual food and beverage competition. I'm sure you have them here. And one part of it was ice carving. And of course, you apply for the competition 3-4 months in advance. And yes, ice carver resigned. Poor old chef was left with nobody. A couple of waiters in the restaurant said, "Chef, can we have a go?" Okay, why not? Now, the competition had been won the previous 5 or 6 years by the Mandarin Oriental. Huge budget. They used to fly in a Japanese ice carver for 2-3 weeks before the event just to train up their team. Well, this was in 1992. Do you know who won that event? Lowly Holiday Inn Crowne Plaza with 3 waiters. So again, anything is possible. And of course, that acclaim and reward for those employees was huge. In Thailand, we call it face. They got enormous face and were the buzz of the town for quite some time. Anybody know who this is? Jamie Oliver. Well, Jamie was a student at Westminster. He wasn't the greatest student. Jamie is dyslexic, and academic studies are not his forte. And I wasn't actually at the college when Jamie studied, but I was there when he came back a few years later. He'd been picked up by BBC TV, working at the River Cafe. And Jamie had decided he wanted to do a project. His project was called 15. And the goal was to take 15 unemployed, unskilled people, bring them in, and train them up to run his restaurant. Jamie's gone on since then. You've got Jamie's Italian. You've got Jamie, who's in fact a huge influence now in the UK. Is he the best chef in the world? No. What's Jamie's skill? Any idea? People. Jamie is a people person. He's got charisma. He's got passion. He's got personality. And in the UK today, if Jamie wants staff, no problem. He'll have a queue. So, again, people skills. Those people skills are all important. Let's look at another position that I'm sure you're all very familiar with, our sous chef or our front of house supervisor. Now, how can they contribute to success? For me, this is your middle management. It's that middle level, and I think it's the most important level. When we look at quality and consistency, they're your supervision. It's your sous chef that normally looks at what goes over the pass. It's the front of house supervisor that is overviewing what is going on in your restaurant. And these are the people that we really need to focus on, because they need skills. They need to have the tools to do their job. They're a great motivator. They motivate the team, but they need to be motivated. And we also start to give other skills to these people. They need to know finance. They need to know some people skills. So is training really a need? Yes, it is. So what can we do to contribute to the training for these this level of people? People skills. How many train their sous chef on how to recruit? Anybody? It's key. Really important. Wrong person in the job, you've got problems for their entire career. Recruitment is a key element. People skills are a key element. And we're talking about kitchens, they're not renowned for having the greatest people skills. Great example here, Gordon Ramsay. We all know him. What's his reputation? Hell's Kitchen. F this, F that, F everything. Is Ramsay like that? No. Ramsay, on his own, is calm, passionate, and caring. I know I've worked with two of his sous chefs, Mark Sargent and Marcus Waring. Both are really gentle, calm people. Product, quality, consistency, creativity, all important at that level. They need time. They need tools. And again, as I mentioned, profit and people skills. Just one little example, cost control. I remember my days as cost controller, big pile of paper. Reality today, you've got the technology, easy, all at your fingertips, but it needs training. So, happy, motivated people stay with you. A little analogy, and I've said this many times in Thailand. You can have the most beautiful building. It's shiny, it's marble, it's gold. It's got an average team. It ain't gonna be a huge success. You can have a rundown building, tired, not dirty, tired and looking a little old. You put a good team in there and the chances are you'll be a great success. So our people, again, our most important asset. Whoops. Oh, we've gone. How did that happen? It's all right. No? Okay, last group. Our manager, our owner. I guess this covers the majority of our audience. You play an equally important role. Product concept, unique selling points. They tend to come from the top. We've got to be special. We've got to be unique. It's like Claridge's Hotel. 3-star Michelin restaurant. The maitre d' there trains the special moment. Every single table should experience a special moment. What is that moment? It's when we do something that is unanticipated. It's something you want. It's something that makes that experience more enjoyable, but you didn't ask for it. You weren't expecting it. Your staff gave it. These are USPs, unique selling points, that can make you hugely special. And yes, of course, we've heard already the importance of systems, the importance of controls. They lay the parameters for you. And of course, from the top, you've got to motivate your team. Good example there, I was in World Travel Mart in London. And do you know the Six Senses hotel chain? There were lots of chefs and F&Bs there. We thought, well, that's odd, but great. Sonu, the owner, had taken the opportunity to bring these guys into London. He then flew them to El Bulli for dinner in Barcelona, the world's number one restaurant. Now, what an experience. It cost him £15,000. But I promise you, every single one of those chefs and F&B directors went away with creativity, with ideas, with motivation, with a passion to achieve their goal. So, is training needed? Sure. Training for managers and for owners, it certainly doesn't stop at the top. Sorry, okay? You're cold. Stand up and have a jump. Feel free. Clearly laying out direction and expectation. Look at your mission. Look at your vision. Does everybody understand that? Is it really cascaded through your product? Does everybody really buy into what you want to achieve? I always say management is quite simple. The right people, the right skills, in the right quantity, in the right place, at the right time. If you could achieve that, you've done a huge chunk of your work. And of course, again, that motivation. Don't forget, passion is infectious. I think you've seen with Mark. Mark is passionate. Mark infects us all. It's amazing how you can change people's thinking. So, conclusions. Done. Training. It is all important. There are many ways we can do it. I say that most of my training is done in coaching. It's bite-sized pieces. It's 10 minutes here. It's 5 minutes there. But you can also do residential training or out-of-the-workplace training. You build the team. You have social interaction. Doing other things can really pull your team together. Last but not least, technology. Now, in the old days where training was actually quite hard to do, it was taking everybody out and having fixed times. Don't need that today. Training can be 24/7. You can make it available to your team that they can do it on the bus on the way home. They can do it sitting in the bath in the evening. Doesn't matter. Make it available to your employees. So, training. Train your team. Make them happy. Make them a great unit, and you will find that success will come. Thank you very much.
Great job. Great. Everybody stand on up. Let's get this thing going. I feel your energy is going down. Let's get things shaped up for the next session before lunch. All right, here we go. Let's get some music going on. Let's give some hugs. Five hugs. Give five hugs. Five hugs. Go for it. Yay! Give those hugs!
You're a good soldier, choosing your battle. Pick yourself up and dust yourself off and back in the saddle. You're on the front fire.
Yay! Bring it on!
You know it's serious, we're getting closer, this isn't over.
Okay, let's jump!
The pressure's off, you feel it. But you got it all. This is Africa. Tamina mina, eh eh. Waka waka, eh eh. Tamina mina, sangalewa. This time for Africa.